Ever since the Chinese invented gunpowder in 1044, we've been getting in trouble ever since. And, you know, fireworks are cool. Nuclear warfare, not so cool. Welcome back, my friends. Today, we're going to watch Molkersgesagt, another nuke video as well. You Americans are nuking things, obsessed with nukes. But anyway, before we get into it, two things. One, KelVPN, the alpha, comes out next week, hopefully. So stick around. Number two, Daily Dance newsletter is coming out, hopefully by the next video. So come back, sign up for that. If you already signed up for KelVPN, I'll just use your email and assume that's okay. But if you didn't sign up for Kel because you weren't interested, which is totally cool, I'll get you to sign up in the next video. And a daily newsletter talking about the latest in science, emerging tech, and business. It's going to be very short, easy to digest. I want to do it because it sounds like fun, and I'm passionate about keeping up to date with the latest in science and things like that. Anyway, let's get into today's video. What if we nuke the moon? People and their bombs. They're obsessed with nukes. Bloody Americans. Just want to nuke everything. Now, I do enjoy these what-if videos, particularly with nukes. They are fun. Have you heard that Christopher Nolan's making a movie about Oppenheimer, the father of the atomic bomb? That's going to be incredible. The guy did Interstellar, Batman. He is a legend. So I'm super excited about that. Maybe I'll have to make a video in the future. So you should subscribe if you want to see that. But anyway, let's watch this video. I don't think I'm going to give my thoughts on what's going to happen here, because I don't want to ruin the surprise if you haven't seen this video, because I think I know what's going to happen. So anyway, let's watch.
What would happen if we were to detonate a very, very powerful nuclear weapon on the moon? Would the explosion knock its orbit towards Earth, causing tidal waves and misery?
No.
Could the moon be destroyed, showering the Earth in a rain of meteoric death?
Nope.
During the Cold War, the moon was a major target for space exploration and, you know, military bases. So, the US Air Force commissioned a serious study into the effects of a nuclear detonation on the surface of the moon.
Let me tell you a story that demonstrates just how crazy Americans are. So in 1957, the Soviet satellite Sputnik successfully orbited Earth, right? Putting Russia ahead. So not to be outdone, the Americans decided they're going to nuke the moon, as you do. The US believed, right, that a lunar explosion visible from Earth would basically showcase American firepower and improve morale from home, right? But look, would seeing a nuclear explosion in the sky improve your peace of mind? I don't know, but I don't think that sounds like a great idea.
But just quoting stuff is boring, so let's conduct a very important scientific experiment with an imaginary 100 megaton thermonuclear warhead about twice as powerful as the most powerful bomb ever detonated. We'll also place a number of curious astronauts around the moon as observers. Let's push the button and slow down time.
That reminds me, I was watching this show called For All Mankind, an Apple series. It's actually really good. It is incredible. I've stopped watching it because I kept watching it and it was, you know, ruining my productivity. But I'll come back to it soon. I'm up to like season 3. It's really good, guys. You should check it out. The series is all about like what if the Soviet Union actually landed on the moon first instead of us, and it goes on from there.
For the first few milliseconds, nothing much happens outside our weapon. Meanwhile, inside, high explosives send a shockwave to a radioactive metal core, compressing it so much that it reaches criticality and starts a nuclear fission chain reaction. Ooh. The 100 million degree plasma created in this first stage sets off the second stage, with atomic nuclei fusing like they do in the core of a star. Very briefly, our weapon contains one of the hottest places in the universe. And only now, barely 10 milliseconds later, does the rest of the universe find out that anything has happened, and a flaming star of nuclear death is born. So far, so good. But everything that happens now is very different from what we're used to on Earth because of one major difference. There's no atmosphere. As the fireball shines, it releases a flash of X-rays and thermal photons, a wave of silent heat which rushes outwards in all directions. On Earth, this heat would char and burn everything within a 50-kilometer radius at least. But on the Moon, without an atmosphere and oxygen-rich air, there's no burning at all. Also, there are no things to burn. The crunchy topsoil of the Moon is made from silicate rock and metals chewed to dust by eons of meteorite impacts mixed with tiny traces of water. When heated by the explosion, X-rays from the fireball vaporize a thin cloud of rock from the lunar surface, while the unlucky dust that's inside the fireball melts into glass. Any astronauts watching the show within about 50 kilometers can expect to be fried. And now we begin to see one of the biggest differences between explosions in space and on Earth. On Earth, the atmosphere fights back against the plasma bubble. Its expansion is violently stopped within moments by the pressure of the atmosphere. But this is not good news. As the fireball rams the atmosphere, it produces the most destructive part of a nuclear explosion on Earth, the shockwave. Compressed air around the explosion rushes out faster than the speed of sound, shattering buildings and roaring so loud it ruptures organs. But on the moon, there is no shockwave. No atmosphere means nothing to impede the expanding explosion in space. On the moon, the fireball just grows in eerie silence as there's no atmosphere to stop it or to give it a voice. This would be an amazing thing to watch from a safe distance. Unfortunately, there's hardly any safe viewing distance for a nuclear explosion on the moon. Without an atmosphere weakening the deadly ionizing radiation that can scramble DNA, anyone close enough to get a good look will be exposed to fatal amounts of radiation. But of course, that's not all. While all of this happens, the explosion hammers against the moon, transferring about a tenth of the explosion energy into seismic waves, powering an intense moonquake. The moon.
Some fun little facts, but the moon is actually shrinking inside, which is causing like quakes on the outer crust. It's kind of like a grape wrinkling into a raisin. So yeah, the moon, I think it's like 50 meters skinnier over the last several million years as the core cools.
The moon is much smaller than the Earth, and our astronauts will feel an inescapable violent shaking no matter where they're standing. Comparable to an earthquake of 7 on the Richter scale, this shaking could seriously damage or even level infrastructure we might have built anywhere on the moon. Those who hit on the far side of the moon would have no idea it was an explosion. The quaking would feel like an asteroid the size of the Great Pyramid had struck. And it's not over yet. Where our bomb explodes, the ground splatters like water when a rock strikes a pond. As the explosion pushes against the surface, it may excavate as much as 100 million cubic meters of dust and rock, forming a crater 1 kilometer across, while bedrock is pulverized to rubble. Debris is shot into the sky in every direction. Again, without an atmosphere, there's no drag to slow any of it down. Much of the debris scattered never returns to the moon, flying off faster than escape velocity. A flurry of micrometeorites have been cast off to explore the solar system, many of which will rain down on the Earth, though few will be larger than pebbles. Any satellite, astronaut, or space station in the way, though, will have a really bad time. Micrometeorites are launched at many speeds and angles, allowing them to spread all over the surface of the moon. Like bullets, they'll punch through our curious astronauts, no matter where they stand. Finally, our explosion comes to an end. On Earth, the fireball rises like a hot air balloon, forming a sort of stalk. As it reaches up, cooler air is drawn in around it, rounding the top into a mushroom cloud. But on the moon, well, you know by now, no atmosphere, no mushroom. The larger the plasma gets, the cooler it becomes, and the less energy it has to make interesting or terrifying things happen. Within seconds of pulling the trigger, the bubble reddens and fades from view. It would be visible from the Earth like a star flickering to life, only to fade out right away. A spark, and then nothing. As the cloud of tiny debris reaches far above the surface of the moon, it's illuminated by the sun for a few minutes, giving it an eerie beauty for anyone left to observe the spectacle. What about the moon's orbit? It's basically unchanged. Trying to move the moon with a nuke is like trying to move a truck by blowing on it. Nuclear explosions may be big, but space is bigger.
The United States actually did a study in the late 1950s and considered this exact thing. They pretty much found out that standard atomic bomb would only create like a microscopic explosion on the moon's surface. And they even considered whether or not it was even possible to blast the moon out of orbit, causing, you know, a bad time for Earth. So what they worked out was their study, the military study, it would take somewhere in the range of 10 billion and 10 trillion megatons of TNT to cause it to leave its orbit. If we detonated every single nuclear bomb on our planet, we'd still only generate 7 1,000 megatons. So if you're worried about the moon leaving Earth, you should probably know that it's already kind of edging away at a very slow rate. But it is, in the long run, it actually will come closer to Earth, and Earth will probably rip it apart. So to move the moon out of its orbit, we'd need to strike it in precisely the right spot, right? With a force like 1.5 million times greater than our like collective nuclear arsenal. And that's assuming every joule of energy from the warheads would be transferred to the moon's motion, which is like an absolute impossibility.
Our mighty explosion just leaves another crater, one among millions. Still, anyone on the moon will continue to not enjoy themselves. The material that ends up raining back to the moon is radioactive, and without any natural processes to wash it away or bury it, the surface of the moon will remain contaminated. Although, fortunately, the worst of the radiation will have decayed to a level comparable to natural levels from cosmic rays in about a year. In conclusion, we can say with confidence that while the moon itself does not care about being nuked, and will barely notice, using the moon as a nuclear test ground kind of ruins it for everyone trying to spend some time there or to build something useful. So maybe we should just not do that.
So a nuclear weapon exploding on the moon. Let's assume it's the Tsar bomber, the 220 hydrogen bomb, the most powerful nuclear bomb ever exploded. The energy released by this is like 217 petajoules, which... that's enough energy for roughly 5.5 million households for an entire year. So back to the moon. So we know the moon is frequently hit by asteroids, right? So in order to ask like this effect of the bomb, let's check how big the asteroid has to be to produce the same energy released. So we know the formula for kinetic energy. You can go to Wikipedia. So we can assume speed of impact. It can be anything from like 25 and 70 kilometers per second, and then we can solve for mass. So a modest speed of 30 kilometers per second, I guess, there's probably more slower rocks than fast ones. So by solving the equation, you can come to some pretty staggering numbers. The rock that would deliver the same impact would have to weigh about 483,000 tons. So if you put that into perspective, it's about the weight of the Burj Khalifa, the tallest building in the world. Anyway, so how big does this asteroid have to be? So your typical space rock can weigh between 1.2 ton per cubic meter to 7 ton per cubic meter or more. So for this exercise, 3 ton per cubic meter is probably a pretty good number. So that results in a volume of 161,000 cubic meters. So since we're terrible at visualizing volume, let's put it into shape. So if it comes in the shape of cube, it'll have side 54.4 meters long. Not that big, right? So if it was the shape of sphere, it would have diameter of 67.5 meters. So with the size of asteroid, you know, we can check how many rocks like that are flying around. With the size of like 70 meters, you fall in the less than 100 meter category, right? And that size isn't even tracked. Too small to care, I guess. So for reference, there's about 25 million asteroids bigger than 100 meters in diameter. So if the moon was hit by this asteroid, it would get a new crater like 1.3 kilometers in diameter. So that would be like the 37th smallest craters out of more than like 1,440 recognized on the moon. So would the moon's orbit change? If all the energy of the impact would be directed in the exact opposite current orbital trajectory, it would cause the moon to slow down by like 2.9 nanometers per second. That's several orders of magnitude lower than what we currently measure in terms of moon's orbital speed. So that means that over the current orbital period, the moon will travel about 6.8 millimeters less. Thus, the orbital period will be longer by 0.00000067s. There might have been one too many zeros.
This was our last video of the year 12,000.
That was a great video. I think the visuals in this one are maybe one of the best I've seen. It was such a good story. Have you ever noticed how all the craters on the moon are round? Like, look through a telescope or some images. All the craters around. What the hell's going on there? Because like you'd assume if something hit it, you know, at an angle, like an asteroid or a comet, surely it would like skid and leave like an oval shape, right? But they're all round. And so scientists used to actually think they were all calderas from volcanic activity, from volcanoes exploding, right? But we realized that Well, we saw a giant asteroid hit Jupiter's outer atmosphere, Shoemaker-Levy, and it exploded, which confused everyone because, it's a gas giant. So why would an asteroid hitting the outer gas layer cause it to explode? And we realized what was happening is this phenomenon some people like to call kinetic death. It's basically where something has so much kinetic energy, it's moving so fast, it has more kinetic energy than chemical energy holding it together. It's kind of like when you throw a snowball at the wall, just explodes, right? Now, if you throw a snowball at the wall, it leaves a round imprint. Throw it at the wall, like straight in front. If you throw it at the wall on an angle, it actually also just leaves a round imprint as it explodes. And this is what happens when asteroids and comets hit the moon. They explode because they're moving so fast. What's holding them together is less than their kinetic energy, and that just explodes on impact, like a snowball hitting the wall from any angle, leaving a round crater. Fun little fact, Carl Sagan was actually on the team of 10 who did this, the calculations for the study of the nuke on the moon. And he was actually the reason we even know about it, because he accidentally, I don't know if it was accidental, disclosed the information about it, the name of it, in an interview. And then a writer who was doing Carl Sagan's biography noted that. And then it actually resulted in the head of that program to come somewhat clean on it. And scarily, this was actually like technically feasible. They had the means to do this. Thank you to Gerzgesagt and the team. Another great video. I'll leave it there. Make sure you subscribe, guys, if you want to see more of these, because I'm going to be watching more Gerzgesagt, and I'll catch you next time.